When it's time to print a booklet, you want to basically do all the settings that we just talked about under File Print, but you need to activate them through File Print Booklet because that allows InDesign to know that you want to create what's called an imposition or imposed book. When you impose something, you arrange it for printing. It's the way that pages are laid out for a printing press. And so if I want to print a 4-page booklet, I have to print page 1 next to page 4, and on the other side of the sheet, I have to print page 2 next to page 3. So that when I fold it in half and I flip through it, I've made a booklet that flips page 1, 2, 3, and then 4. It gets more complicated if you have more pages. So there are 8 pages for project 1, so you're going to end up having 2 signatures, which is one big sheet of paper folded down to make multiple smaller sheets. And so you're going to have 2 sheets of paper that are folded in half, and each sheet of paper is going to have 4 pages. But what if you had 156 pages for your book? It wouldn't be that easy to figure out where the pages go and which ones have to go next to each other. And so what we do is we create our document in InDesign visually from a designer's point of view, and we do it in what are called reader spreads in the order that you want to read them. And so if I have 156 pages in my project, I have 156 pages in my InDesign project, and page 1 is the first one, and page 2, and then page 3, and page 4, even though when I print it, page 1 might print next to page 156, so they should be next to each other. But in InDesign, I'm going to do it the easier way, and I'm just going to look at them in the order that I would read them. When I go to print it, if I choose print booklet, InDesign will help me figure out where those pages go, and it will automatically place them in that order so that when I print, I can fold and assemble and then bind a book together. When you are printing a booklet, you'll get a dialog box that looks similar to the one that's on my screen, and on the left-hand side, there are 3 tabs, the setup, the preview, and the summary. Under the setup tab, all I want you to do is choose the page range and the booklet type, and your page range should be all pages. Your booklet type for this project will be 2-up saddle stitched, meaning it has 2 pages across, and when you fold the page in half, you'll actually get 4 pages out of each sheet of paper. Under the preview tab, Under the preview tab, what I want you to do is just make sure you don't have red. And so right now I look at the preview and I don't have red, so I'm good to go. I'm going to skip over that for now though, and then I'm going to go to the print settings dialog box over here. By clicking this little button, print settings, it will open that same exact dialog box and it will allow me to choose settings for my project. Now, I'm going to demo this step by step when I go to do the demo for at the end of the lecture. So keep that in mind, but the print settings, you have to choose your paper size, do you want to print blank pages or not? You need to choose your color mode, CMYK composite or composite CMYK, etc. The same way that you would choose them if you're printing a regular project like we talked about for printing just using File Print. What's different is that when you're done and you hit OK, it's going to bring you back to this print booklet dialog box, and you need to make sure that you don't see any red in this preview panel. And by default, your booklet will not be horizontal like you see it on my screen. It will be rotated and it will be portrait, and it will stick off the edge of the page and you will see red. If you see red or you don't see something that you want to see, you have to go back into the print settings dialog box and change the orientation until it rotates it so that you don't see red when you come back to the preview. Also, if you're printing this on campus, by default, the booklet will not print on 2 sides of the sheet of paper. And so while you're in the print settings dialog box, let's go back, you'll have to hit the printer icon at the bottom. And inside the printer icon, you can choose to print your project on 2 sides. You will have to choose either short edge or long edge binding. It's easier for me to explain that when I'm demoing the printing, so I'll explain how you would know which one to choose. But basically, you want to decide which side of the sheet you want the paper to flip on. Do you want it to flip on the short side when it's printing, or do you want it to flip on the long side? And then that's how you can choose which way you want the booklet to print. So before we go to the demo portion, which is much easier to understand when I'm demoing how to print the booklet, let's talk about color separations. And so for all of your projects, well, I think for like 8 of your projects in Art 1200, you're going to need to output a color separation, which is a breaking down of the color in an image or a page in a project into the colors that it will be printed with. Most often that's cyan, magenta, yellow, and black, because those are the printing process colors. but it doesn't have to be those colors. You could print with blue and black, or you could print with cyan, magenta, yellow, black, and purple. The purple would be a spot color because you're not making purple out of a combination of magenta and cyan. You're going to buy purple ink. But if you are not using spot colors, it will be CMYK for printing. And what we do is we isolate those colors so that when we print on a printing press, we only have to print with four colors, and when we overlap those colors, which are transparent inks, we will create an image that represents a full color image. And so I'll print yellow, and I can print magenta, and I can print cyan, and I can print black, and after they're all layered one on top of another, they will recreate a colored image. If you think about it, if we were not to use this process of using four colors to recreate all the other colors that we'd want, we would have to have millions of different colors on our printing press, and that would be astronomical to print. However, this example is a little misleading. When I ask you to make a color separation, I'm not asking you to print a yellow page and a cyan page and a magenta page and a black page. I'm asking you to print black and white pages because color separations are grayscale. They are black and white. They represent the density of the color. And so the black one will look like the example here. It will be black and white, and it will represent the density of black. And you can see that the background of this bird image is black, and so there's a lot of black in the background. But the bird has very little black, and you can see that there's not a lot of black in the image. If I look at cyan, there is a lot of blue in the bird. And so if I was to look at a grayscale version of the cyan color separation, it would be very dark in the bird, and it would be very dark in the background, because this black back here, it's not made up of black. It's made up of a lot of yellow, a lot of magenta, a lot of cyan, and a lot of black. Color separations, like I said, do not have to be CMYK. So the example on the left is a two-spot color project. It's printing with yellow, and it's printing with black. And that's common for newsletters a lot of the times, and you'll do a two-color project in my class, and you'll do a two-color project in a couple of your other graphic design classes as well. But the idea is that I take all the colors in the image and I break them down into channels of color that represent where that color happens to be in the image. And so, you can see that all the yellow is in the background. And so I would print the yellow first in the background, and I would use a printing plate to do that. And then I would have a separate printing plate just for where the black is. But just because I'm showing you this as yellow and black side by side, when I output a color separation and I use that color separation to make a printing plate, they're both going to be black. They're both going to be shades of black and gray that represent the density of the color being applied. The only time color is added to a color separation is when you add ink to a printing press, and the color of ink that you're using will adhere to all the black areas on the plate. And so if I wasn't printing this solar image in black, let's say it was supposed to be, navy blue, when I put this on my printing press, it would look exactly like you're seeing it here. But as I add ink to the printing press, all the blue ink would adhere everywhere that there's black, and more blue ink would adhere where it's darker black, and less blue ink would adhere where it's lighter black. And then when I make contact between that printing plate and eventually the paper it's applied to, that's how I can transfer the image from the printing plate onto the paper and have it be blue. I hope that makes sense. You're not really expected to be a master of offset printing in the InDesign class, but you will take, or hopefully you will take, ART 1135 Printing Fundamentals, where you learn how to run printing presses, and this will all make more sense. Also in this example, you can see that as you apply, here's another example, as you apply layers of color, you can create full color images. So in this example, they printed cyan first, and then they printed magenta over the top, and it kind of looked kind of cool and funky. Then they printed yellow over the top of that, and it, in theory, these three colors create a full color image, but it still doesn't look quite right. And so we add K, which CMYK, the K stands for black. We add a pop of black over the top so that it makes all the other colors pop, and it actually looks like a full color image. So why are color separations important, and why do I make you make them? They are important because they show what colors your image is made from, and so you could quickly see if you're using cyan, magenta, yellow, black, or spot colors, or both. You also see the density of the ink being applied, so you can see how much ink you're going to need. My background is in commercial printing, and I was responsible for figuring out how much it would cost to print jobs. And a lot of the times jobs will come in and you don't get files when you're doing quotes. You get information like, this is a 28 page plus cover brochure and we're going to do this, this, and this, and this to it. And so the client would say, okay, well, I want a print with CMYK plus I want spot silver on the front cover. And you're like, okay, well, we're printing a million of these brochures, so I need to know how much silver. And so you ask the customer, like, is it like flood coverage, meaning it's all over? Is it just a little bit? Is it like a 2-inch by 2-inch square? If they were to send me their files and we were to output a color separation, I would know exactly how much ink is on each page. And I could use that information, right, to figure out how much ink I need for one cover, multiply that times a million, and I can get an accurate answer for how much ink is needed. A lot of times they just said, well, just calculate average. And so I would do very low amounts because usually when you have spot silver, it's just a pop of color here or there. And so on my quote, I would say less than 5% ink coverage on front cover. And so if the quote came back and the client really liked the price and they sent the job in, and then they had flood coverage, so it was basically a silver cover, a million copies, the difference between having 5% ink coverage of a color and 100% ink coverage could be an astronomical cost. And that could be the reason that the client went with us, because our price was probably low. But if the client had let us know from the beginning exactly how much of the area was covered in that spot silver color, then we could have given a more accurate price. Not to go on a tangent here, but for your reference, most of you will probably become graphic designers of some sort. If you're sending jobs to a commercial printer and you don't specify, the estimate should specify whoever the estimator is. And if they said 5% ink coverage on the cover and it is clearly stated on the quote, and you come in with a job that has 95% ink coverage of that expensive spot silver color, the commercial printer is not responsible for that additional cost. You would be responsible as the person who didn't read the quote. It also helps you catch any potential errors. So if you create a color separation and you see where ink is being applied, you could say, well, there's not supposed to be ink there, or there's not supposed to be a spot color in this job, and you can kind of eliminate errors before they happen in the production or the print production process. And then you can also check your trap and your bleed settings. So we haven't learned about either of those, but you would be able to check those. And we will eventually learn about them.